Moving on, I've gone all around the Wolf Civic. I tell you what, it's like I felt like a kid in a sweet factory in the shop. I'm now with a legend, the drummer of Paul Weller, Steve Pilgrim. How are you, mate?
I'm very well, sir. How are you?
Thank you very much. And you've just walked me all around here. I've been by the stage.
We had to find a quiet spot, didn't we? And it took us a while.
Tell you, mate, you'll have to excuse me for being just so excited, because I just can't believe it. I'm kind of looking through a door and like, don't look, because Paul Weller might be in that door. You know, I'm just so excited. So thanks very much for joining me. Now, we're here today. Paul's in town. I do hashtag him God, because in my book, Weller is God. Steve Pilgrim, tell me all about B1%, because that's what I want to talk to you about, your charity as well as.
I started up a small giving network a couple of years ago. Mm-hmm. We started with just a small group of friends, and we decided to give 1% of our income to raise money for anti-poverty initiations. So we all stuck our money in 1 month. There was eight of us, and we all gave our 1% into the pot, and mm-hmm. we raised £166 in that first month. And we gave that to malaria treatments, mm-hmm. which was enough to provide malaria treatments for 333 people. Yeah. And we just thought off the back of that, like one month of eight people doing it, if we could do that with just eight people, what could we do if we had 100 people or 1,000 people doing it? And so we started to build the network, and month on month, the network of people giving their 1% has grown and grown. And now we raise around £4,000 a month, and mm-hmm. give that to different like poverty and poverty alleviation projects.
So, what started you in the first place? Did you look at things like, I mean, Live Aid many years ago were doing things like this?
I suppose it's something that maybe for my generation, I was quite young, sort of in the mid '80s when Live Aid happened and all of that happened, and that was quite a big sort of shock for me as a child, and then seeing that sort of ongoing, that there's still really big poverty problems in those poorer countries in Africa and elsewhere, and just thought, well, you know, if I could do something about that in my lifetime, mm-hmm. even if it was something very small, if I could do something for some other people, then why not, you know? It's a really funny time, because economically the whole country's in a really bad state, and you know, for a lot of people, whether they consider themselves working class or middle class or whatever, people are finding it harder and harder to make ends meet, you know. So it's a difficult time to sort of be pitching a charity to ask people to give money, but at the same time, people can spend a lot of money on going out and getting drunk and you know, like, I mean, I do myself, you know. I'm not alone in that, but it's really, really easy to spend a lot of money on quite wasteful things a lot of the time. And actually, if you were to just say, oh, well, I give 1% and I know I'll give that every month, and I know that's going to do something positive, and it just kind of went from there, really, and it's got away with itself. And so anybody that wants to join us, they can find out about becoming a member at b1%.org and sign up there. And you know, the more the merrier, really, and we do great things every month. All the money, 100% of the money, goes to the projects,
and that's the nice thing. I mean, the fact of B1%, you're talking anything from us working class people, anything from £2 to £5, really. That's all it is a week. It's no more than a decent or an half decent bottle of wine, a couple of bottles of beer. If you go into a pub, you and I, Steve, I'll go and buy you a drink. It's going to be at least a fiver. So that's what we're talking about, and that £5 maximum. I mean, my, like, you know, we don't want to give any our salaries away, but I donate £4 a week. Because that's the kind of like bracket that I'm in.
Absolutely.
And I'll gladly give you the £4 a week.
Sure.
You know, well, because it does go to a great cause. You've got your videos up there as well. Tell me about that.
We're really lucky to put together a trip to Malawi. So we self-funded. I was lucky enough to be able to self-fund the trip with somebody else, and we went over to look at some of the projects we'd supported in Malawi through our partner charities. So we went to some of the schools that we'd sponsored feeding in, and we looked at different medical initiatives and surveys that they're doing for malaria nets and all of these kinds of things, and savings and credits co-ops, and we went to see all of these different initiatives, and it was just a very strange experience to go to somewhere that's so much different, so much poorer in the way that it is. It's, you know, farmland in the middle of nowhere, and people are literally living on grain. It's like going to another planet or something, unless you actually go there and experience it. And I suppose when you see that kind of thing on TV, you see that kind of thing on Comic Relief or Children in Need, and you think, oh, they must be going to a particularly poor place, but like it seemed that that was just the way the country was. That was quite normal. So, but to be able to connect with those people, with those schools that we've sponsored feeding, and meet the teachers, and actually see the difference we're making, was just really, really, really special, you know. So that was in it. We made some short films that are on the website as well that you can see. Yeah.
And let's give another plug for that website, which is...
B1%, which is all in words. That's BEONEPERCENT.org.
And also on Twitter, you do a lot of work on Twitter. Your missus gets involved with the tweeting as well, doesn't she?
Yeah, that's our Twitter handle is B1%. And the same for Facebook as well, facebook.com/B1%.
Now, I got involved in it one Saturday night while missus was out. You know, it's like you have a glass of wine and you're sitting there and you're looking online. Yeah. And this young lady come on there, Hannah Weller.
Yeah.
Anything I say with Weller, whether it's Leah or Anna or Paul don't tweet and stuff.
Yeah.
So I looked at it and she was like a woman possessed that night.
Yeah.
She went ballistic with it. Yeah. So I'm thinking... I'd had a bit of interaction with Anna before, because a lot of times with, you know, your stars, your heroes and blue ticks and that, they never get back. But like, she got back and I was going, right, okay, I'll help you, Bab. And then DM'd and we was done. And I said, look, and it was literally, I didn't care who she was.
Yeah.
The fact that this person was working their backside off for something and for other people.
Yeah.
And I says, mate, I'll help you. And I think we went all around the world. We went through all the Twitter, all the followers, all my West Ham connections and everything, and Birmingham City, and we reached and touched a lot of people. How did that impact the charity? Did you get much from it?
Yeah, we got, I think there were a number of, like, people could sign up about inquiries.
Yeah.
I don't know how many of those. I think a handful of those might have actually turned to members. So it definitely made a difference. What was amazing about it was, because I watched it unfold as well, because I was trying to keep up.
It literally was going bananas, wasn't it?
I think it was only one day, though. It was only really done over a couple, 2 days, like 48-hour period, where she just went crazy on it. And it was fab, yeah. Like, we got a lot of contact back off that. So we're going to do more. We're going to try and do more of that kind of thing. We were thinking about doing Twitter hijacks. So we were going to try and target some people who may be particularly high profile and say, could we borrow your account for a day?
No, I'd be crying.
And, you know, and go crazy. So I'm talking to Hannah about that, and see if she might volunteer to do that for us, which would just
Through our radio show, through my Moore show, which is Solihull Moors and everything Solihull with Craddock, we're backing Craddock's album, Travel Wild, Travel Free. We'll talk about your albums shortly as well. What I want to do is, if it's okay with you, because I always start my show off with one from Weller, and then I end up having two and three and four from Weller.
Yeah.
If it's all right, I'll put supporting B1% and I'll tag it to the shows that we've got.
That'd be fantastic.
And things like that, the simple things like that is getting your message out.
That's right.
Now, if you want to celebrity stalk me, Steve, that's not absolutely not a problem, because we are the number one podcast sports radio. We are the number one podcast brand on the Podomatic charts.
Mm-hmm.
We're the biggest in the world, mate. We've got listeners in Ghana. We've got, like Paul Dunning, like 78, all around the world. We are all around the world.
Yeah.
Africa, Asia,
yeah.
Europe. We've even got Tasmania as well, following on it. So we're all out. So if you want to hijack sports radio and the Biscuit Boys, because Chris and I, we're the Biscuit Boys, we've got two shows. The Moore Show, which is this speech one where I go out and about and talk to people. The other one is we play records. And I want to talk to you about your records, your solo career as well.
Okay.
So what we do, we just put anything that I like. Chris likes Genesis and things like that, and Led Zeppelin, and he's a bit of a rocker. but I'm more kind of like modern Weller. So, and I get my own way. So about 15 songs, where we'd be Miles Kane or Paul Weller or Steve Paddock and that, forget his Genesis, right, and we just play our stuff. So I'm going to get a couple of your CDs,
yeah, sure,
and I'll plug your music.
Fantastic.
And like, same as Andy Lewis, I mean, Andy's got some CDs out. So any of the boys, yeah, you know, that have got CDs, and I'll pay you for them, it's not a problem, you
no,
know.
No problem, yeah.
I'll, it's all right. That's entertainment, isn't it?
Yeah, that's normal, that.
So any of your stuff, like, we will plug it like mad. Because we do put the trailer on, and we've got a massive biscuit tin.
Okay.
You know, like, you have, like, a Wurlitzer thing, you know, your jukebox. Mm-hmm. We ain't got one to piddle in, to be fair. Right, so we've got a biscuit tin. So all the music that gets chucked in, if you, like, email us that, Chris@sports-radio.co.uk. Anyone that does that, it all goes in the biscuit tin, and then we play it.
Lovely.
So all your music will be in that biscuit tin.
Lovely.
That's how we work. We're the Biscuit Boys. Your favourite biscuit? Because I have to ask everybody that. What is your favourite biscuit?
Favourite biscuit?
Yeah.
Ooh.
Rock and roll question.
It's proper rock and roll, ain't it?
I think I've really got into my chocolate hobnobs recently. It's quite a superior biscuit, isn't it? You know what I mean? You can't get nuts on them, really.
Yeah.
You've got to pace yourself on them, but
you have, yeah.
It's a great biscuit, though.
So it is all about the biscuits. And
I think it's a meal in itself, though, like a chocolate.
Tell me about it,
a chocolate hobnob, isn't it?
Well, we've done a YouTube thing with a Twix bar today.
Yeah.
Ah, so I like Twixes.
Twixes?
Yeah, Twix, yeah. Chris reckon every Twix in the world is the same. I didn't think so.
So you did an experiment?
I get it. Kind of ate the evidence. So your solo career, mate, you've got two albums out.
Three albums.
And how many bands are you in? Because I've looked at your feed last night. You're prolific. All you guys, you are so busy in the music industry.
You've got to be. That's the only way to survive in this business.
Yeah.
So I keep myself very busy. I get involved with any project that interests me, really. And there's a lot of different stuff I've been involved in over the years, whether that's been very small touring bands or recording work or whatever. So and then the last couple of years I've worked with Cast, and I've worked with a lady called Rachel Wright, who sang on my recordings, mm-hmm. and I've recorded drums for her recently. So I've been a busy boy. I think it might have been early last year I put out my last record, was called Pixels and Paper, which I recorded down at the barn, which is Paul's studio.
Mm-hmm.
Again, big thanks to Paul for his generosity with helping us out on that.
He does that, doesn't he, with young bands, and helps you.
Yeah, just generally, there's young bands out there at the moment who are coming into his studio and who he's never met before, and if he likes something, he'll open his door to it. And he's a fantastic supporter and champion of new music in that way. So it was just great. He played on a couple of tracks.
Does he have biscuits in the black barn?
I would. Mate,
so I'll give Paul a load of biscuits.
I'm not joking here.
Huh?
The records that we make are made on tea and biscuits.
So Paul Weller is a biscuit boy, you know.
I think he might be. Yeah,
fantastic.
I'm definitely a biscuit boy. I can guarantee that.
We're all in a gang, game. It's like it's the Mad Father Biscuit Boys. You know, I think we can brand this, Steve. I think we're going to take over the world. We'd be 1%. Swear, it is. So I go off piste.
I've noticed.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I don't like skiing straight in the middle. We're a bit alternative. But what kind of success have you been having with your albums?
Minimal, if I'm brutally honest.
Okay.
It's hard to get your stuff out there, particularly when I've been touring with other things, and to find the time and space to promote things properly has been difficult. But the feedback I've had from the people that have heard what I've done has always been really positive, and I think you can, if you've got my albums, you can hear the progressions in them, and the newest stuff is sort of the most comprehensive, the most full sounding, there's more going on instrumentally with them, so I'm really pleased and proud of particularly the last record, and I'm in the process of starting to write for the next record, so I'll be getting the boys together in a room, and we'll be running through some stuff to work on album before, and it's just yeah, just I've got the opportunity to make music and I can, and I'll carry on doing it as long as the world will let me.
I'm sure it will. So make sure that I get them, because I swear, I mean, I will, but yeah, I'll plug it like mad.
Of course I'll pass albums on to you, no problem.
I'm like, you know, any of our boys, mate, our team, well, I'll look after you. And that accent, it's a Scouse accent. You could almost be in Peaky Blinders.
Yeah, I've not seen that.
You're not seen it? All right, lad, how are you? It's one of them, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. You're going to ask me a football question, though, aren't you?
Liverpool or Everton?
I'm coming on a sports programme and I don't follow football.
You're joking, do you not?
I'm a Scouser that doesn't follow football.
Blimey.
Can you believe that? I mean, that doesn't make any sense, does it?
No.
If I was to say a team,
no,
I'm
City supporters, we don't follow football.
Well, I'm a Red by default because my family are Reds, and I've got season tickets in my family. So when I was very young, I used to watch Liverpool. But now, if somebody asks me a football question in a pub in Liverpool, I tend to make my excuses and head in the opposite direction.
Well, you just tell them you're Paul Weller's drummer. That's sort of the trump card, isn't it?
All I've got in my head is drum beats and
exactly.
Guitar lines and stuff. That's what's going on in my brain.
My niece, she's a drummer. My niece is she's at college and she's been doing all these courses and she's done the dissertation and all this stuff. And she's been doing all the drumming and that. Like, she's barmy on it. She's absolutely. And that's all that's in her head.
Yeah.
And she's constantly trying to write different songs and tunes just to suit the drumming.
Yeah.
Sort of thing, because she's mad on it.
That voice there that you can hear, guys, is Glue, the guy called Glue. He's my partner, he's my right-hand man, he's my soulmate. We're not like that, to be fair. But, you know, we put these events together, like the Kingshurst event. Love to get you down there. We had 2,000 at our Kingshurst event. 5 bands, young bands.
Great.
Proper smashed it. It was brilliant.
And there's no reason why we couldn't have a B1% day?
Well, we did actually. Right. We did have a B1% stage, didn't we? But then we lost the stage. So we'll name it after you.
We raised on the day $4,500.
That's fantastic.
Right, but nobody would sponsor the day, so we had to pay all the expenses.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, we think we've got about $2,000 going to the charities.
Yeah.
So which ain't bad. And that, like, next year, we want to try and get better bands, bigger bands.
Hmm. I'll be honest, we're after Paul Weller. That's what we're after.
We're
after God.
That's what you want.
You know, I would say to nick one of his titles, Aim High. That's a great track as well, isn't it?
That's a fantastic track, yeah.
Because, you know, when you got involved with Paul on the 22 Dreams album, didn't you? That's your first album with him.
I didn't record on that record, but I was involved pretty much from as soon as it was released, right through all the promotion of it. So we toured that record, and back in 2000, that's like nearly 6 years ago now.
Time flies.
And it's absolutely flown by. Yeah.
I've got every album since 1977.
Everyone. Did you buy them in order?
I kind of, like, you know, yeah.
Did you?
You know what I mean?
Wow.
I've got on this, I swear, honestly.
Never
I've never. My iPod, when I tweet up, Gabbie FM, 744 Paul Weller songs on there. Biscuit, superb. How's the tour been going in here? What was that about the capes as well?
They came from Port Merion. That's a reference to the prisoner, because they were the cloaks from the prisoner.
Oh right.
So there's a factory in Port Merion that make them or something, and they've been sent up as a gift, I think, just as a souvenir for Paul. And then we were kind of joking, saying, "Oh, should we put them on?" So there wasn't enough for the whole band. So, but we've had a fresh order of capes tonight.
Blimey.
This is an exclusive.
We do exclusive. We are the number one chart,
and we'll be wearing our capes, I would imagine, later this evening.
Do you wear them for the whole gig or just
just for the encore?
Oh right, okay.
Just for fun.
Fair play. So, I mean, it did get Twitter going a bit, like,
did it?
But, yeah, it did. They were like, it must be the move of the Fire Brigade and different things, and people were having their say of what song. And it was nothing to do with that, it was the prisoner.
It was the prisoner, yeah.
So it was just like as random as I'm going to send you a bag of biscuits, they sent you a load of capes.
It properly was a random thing, yeah. But, you know, if you like the prisoner, why not?
And the tour, how's it gone? Sold out all over the place, haven't you?
It's been fab. We've we've had some good shows and some bad shows, but generally I think the set's been put together really well. Mm-hmm. There's the usual sort of usual comeback from a lot of the message boards and stuff about the stuff we've been playing, sort of a long-standing issue with the Weller community about what songs Paul chooses to play or not play.
Yeah.
But personally, from where I'm sitting, I think it's a really interesting set of songs. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of stuff off the last three records, but there's also a lot of stuff that we've not played before from his other solos, early solo
yeah.
stuff. And Style Council, there's a Style Council track, I think. And
yeah, I think it's the Soul Clean one, isn't it?
Yeah, we
Moods.
We play Moods, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a great video that was as well. But I think the thing is with Paul, I mean, Paul's wrote so many songs. It must be like picking like the Spanish national team. Mm. Who'd you leave out?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
and that's the thing.
Yeah.
Well, you're doing about 23, 25 tracks, aren't you, overnight? To get 25 from the amount of songs that is written must be almost impossible. Mm. And like, I'll be honest, as a massive fan, I couldn't care if I went out there and paid 30, 40 quid, Paul Weller sang Christmas carols or nursery rhymes, I don't care.
Yeah.
It's just about that, and like, whatever he decides to put out there, he's bang on with me, mate.
I think it leaves some people bemused, you know, you go to some towns and people haven't maybe not heard stuff off the new recordings, and some people come along expecting to hear the greatest hits or whatever, and they're just not going to get
well, it's
that.
Not that, is it, Steve? No.
So, Paul's always been an artist that's pushed forwards, and that's still as true today as it has ever been, and I think that's the only way it can be, really.
And it is, you know, when you get a song, do you have to learn the lyrics as well as the beats? Do you just get the music, or do you get the words as well?
We got lyric sheets, and I pick out certain lyrics for harmonies and stuff like that.
Seven and
like
three is the striker's name. What do you think when you got hold of that? He's at it again.
I was a little bit scared, yeah.
Because he's always weighing the establishment up, ain't he?
Yes, yeah.
You know, and I think that's the thing with Paul, and I think that's why at times he don't get what I would perceive the press that he really does deserve, because he don't. And I've never met the guy, but through his lyrics and through watching his career, he's never suffered fools gladly. And if he's got something to say, he'll say it. And he appears as though he's not one of these that will kind of like, I'll give a little bit. He's like the old lot's gone, ain't it? And you know, some of those lyrics, you must get some and just think, Jesus, you actually wrote that.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
But yeah, who better to do it than him, you know?
Yeah. Have you got any favourite songs that you enjoy playing, or is that just
on this tour at the moment?
Yeah.
I think my favourites are in the encores that we're doing. There's a set of songs we come back on and do at the end. We're doing a version of Sinking, which is like a really relaxed chill out version of that, which I'm really enjoying how that feels. Feels great. There's a version of Sticks we're doing at the moment, so I'm trying to get to grips with the drum solo.
No, you get a right proper drum solo with that, don't you?
Yeah, so I'm trying to make the best of that and enjoy that. And the other track I'm really enjoying is Be Happy Children.
Great song.
Which is off Sonic
The last
Kicks.
One off Sonic Kicks.
That song makes me cry like every night we play it.
Yeah.
I mean, because it's the end of the set and I'm knackered.
Yeah.
but in all seriousness, I've had a little boy, I've got another kid on the way, and that song, it gets me, you know, just the sentiment on it, really, you know. So
I think that's
probably my favourite.
Paul's always done that, in Moon on My Pyjamas and stuff like that. He's always had a thing for the kids. He's always been quite private, you know, but we'll put things like that in his lyrics, you know, to his kids. And you know, I think that I've got my little girl, she's five. She actually phoned me up tonight because we're like, Dad, well, Paul, she knows I'm a Paul Weller. She said, Daddy, if you see Paul Weller, you know what I mean? Ask him to play Eating Rifles. She loves that. She absolutely loves it.
I'll ask him to what he says.
I'm guessing the answer's no.
If it's not, I'm there.
But the thing is, she's five, she loves Paul Weller as well.
Yeah.
And his music lives on from generation to generation, and it's passed down. and I think we're going to leave it on that beautiful note.
Thank you very much for your time.
Be happy, children.
Absolutely.
And if anybody else wants to have a word with the Gabster,
I'll see what I can do.
Oh, Steve,
I'll
have a word, man. I'll be around.
All right. Well, I just said you want to speak to you.
Yeah. But Steve, really appreciate it. Top draw. Anything that I can do, we're Twitter mates and stuff, we're proper buddies and biscuit boys now.
Just put it out like anything.
And we'll
just put it in.
You know, we'll bang it.
A lot of blues fans are massive fans of Paul and all that,
And also as well, and I must say, if you just tell this to Paul, I know he doesn't tweet, but we had a Birmingham City fan that passed away recently, Wire. Okay. And Paul had put on the Paul Weller HQ to Dean Kenny, you know, rest in peace. And that went down unbelievably well. Yeah. I was at the funeral, and the amount of blues fans that says, like, Gabby, like, well, he's God, ain't he? Yeah. And, like, you know, absolute top respect. That meant so much to a lot of people. So if you just tell Paul, thanks very much. That did not go unnoticed by the family and by our Birmingham City family as well.
Yeah, OK, I'll pass that message on.
Keep right on.
All right, mate.
Cheers, Steve. Thanks for your time, mate.
No problem.
And have a great set.
Yeah.
I'll be out there watching you.
So you're a 1% member?
Yes, I am. Yeah. I signed up the day when Anna was going absolutely...
Nice to meet you.
That's OK, mate. Well, that. Well, blimey, I think we nearly knocked it off then. It's all right, my wood's gone. You know. But no, as soon as Anna was doing that then, I joined up and that. I always, you know, I often open my mouth and put my foot in it and what have you, but to be fair... I think it's a great cause. It's a great cause. We'll get all the way. Thanks, mate.
He's heading a minute.
Right, he's getting violent. He always does. Cheers, mate. Thank you.
This is called Firecracker.
Firecracker smacking back along the last and lonely track. Cause I think I've been trapped inside the web of my own truth and last. You may be found a fleeting foot on changing ground. So pick a star and throw a stone. You won't need no directional tonight. From my open book, I don't need much but the same thing back, so please say you can grant me that tonight. Find something, lose something, build something, break something, hear something, say something, you might create something right. You've given it. You had no choice but choose to win or lose and sit outside the game. Watch it spin and spin again tonight. Find something, lose something, build something, break something, hit something, say something, steal something, pay something, lose something, shake something, love someone, make something. Things that made you, you are skewed. The glittering goals that eat at you reside, but don't ignite in you tonight. Find something, lose something, build something, wreck something, hear something, say something, steal something, pay something, move something, shake something, give something, take something, love someone, make something.
very much. Thank you.
Joining me now on the Moore Show, it's rather noisy, we're backstage, a solo legend, the biggest name in Solio, Steve Craddock, how are you?
Yeah, I'm good, man, yeah.
What an
introduction that was.
But you are, Steve, aren't you? A former pupil of Lodeef School,
yeah.
Ocean Colour Scene. Years and years ago, in another life, when you started Ocean Colour Scene, I picked you up in the cab and I took you to Stratford House.
Right, okay.
When your first album.
Yeah, that's where our first manager used to live, yeah.
Yeah. How far have you come? From that time.
Well, it's only about 9 miles, isn't it, I think, because we're in Wolves tonight, so yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
But like,
9 miles in.
Tell me about your album. I mean, I've got your album, Travel Wild, Travel Free, Doodlebook, love Doodlebook, and Shia in the...
Inertia.
Yeah, I know. Me and Chris were sitting in the studio, we didn't know what it meant.
I don't.
He's from Ladywood, and I'm from Kingshurst.
Yeah.
I ain't got a clue. It means idleness.
Is that what it means?
Yeah, it's a great word.
I thought this. I read it in a review. There was someone reviewing the last.
Okay, yeah.
And it was inside a CD package, and it just goes, "This is just sheer inertia."
Brilliant.
Which is it? Mean laziness?
Does it? Yeah.
Oh shit! but I just like the way that sheer and inertia were kind of.
It works.
Sort of opposite each other, but
Steve,
there you
superb.
Go.
Superb.
All right.
I'll be honest. I bought the album. I went to bed the night after. That song was in my head. And I woke up, I don't tell lies, I don't do any of that. Glue it, I swear, glue it. I say it as I see it. That tune is an absolute banging tune.
Right, yeah, well, thank you.
And also, like, your first album as well, The Apple, Not Falling Far From The Tree.
Yeah.
That's a great family song as well.
Yeah, it is, yeah. I was really proud of that when I wrote that. Well, thank you, you know, it's really nice to hear someone being encouraging about music.
And Sally, your missus, she's the one on the horse on the...
That's right, yeah. She's the horse.
God, you've got to keep that point.
Yeah, she is. She sings on a couple of parts of the album, and she sort of helped me out with the production. You know, you just kind of, it's a Mr. and Mrs. kind of show, really. You know.
And your connection with Paul Weller, I mean, it goes back years.
20 years I've been working for him now.
It's frightening, isn't it?
Yeah.
And in your own right, 1st of November, you're at the Institute.
That's
you're
right.
In London during the day.
Yeah.
And of a night, you're in Birmingham.
That's right, yeah.
You're so busy. And Ocean Colour Scene on the 14th of December as well.
Yeah.
Mate, how do you find time for everything?
I don't know. I've sort of got two kids somewhere. I've sort of got faint memories of what they used to be like. But, you know, I think you've got to take it while it's around, haven't you? You know? So...
And Paul Weller, you're a massive... Jam fan when you were a kid.
We kind of all were around that time, weren't we? That was all that was, I mean, I didn't really like any of the other sort of mod bands, if I'm honest.
Yeah.
I thought they were a bit pony, but the Jam were an amazing English band, you know.
Yeah.
And of course, around that time, it was all the two-tone stuff, wasn't it, in Birmingham?
Yeah.
So you'd have all the two-tone gear going on, and you'd be 40's first album.
Yeah.
Anyway, he can't write his songs, but he's got all his ass.
That'd do for me. Did Paul call me a tosser then? That'd do for me. That's right. Can I claim it?
Yeah, you can.
Thanks, mate.
No, you won't. Is that alright?
Yeah, brilliant, mate. That's right, superb. Yeah, Steve, legend, have a great set tonight.
Yeah, great.
I've said to Steve Pilgrim earlier, the difficulty with Paul doing one is what you leave out. There is so much wonderful work through a career that spans from 77 till now.
Yeah.
And I think he gets like a bottle of wine, like that red you're drinking, it matures.
Yeah.
Year on year out.
What a lovely
analogy. What a lovely mate.
Yeah, great.
Have a great one.
Yeah, nice one.
Keep right on.
I will do.
And up the villa as well, I'll say that
up
to you.
Up the villa.
Cheers, Steve. Thanks, mate. Cheers, pal. Joining me now on the Moore Show, me old mucker, Jack the Biscuit. Daz, how you going?
I'm alright, Gavs. How you going? Yeah,
quite
all right, yeah.
What a venue. It's great, isn't it? And God's in town.
God's in town. What? With the boys.
So what do you reckon? What's your thoughts?
Well, walking in, how many people don't like him?
Oh, they do, don't they? That is the thing with Paul Weller concert. You know,
exactly.
I've got no air, so I can't do that.
Mine's going.
Yeah, and some people like to that pay homage in that way, and, you know, full respect and that, but you can tell some Paul Weller fans by just looking that they want to be Paul Weller.
Well, he looks cool, though, he dresses nice. The Mud Father?
We've all wanted to be Paul Weller, haven't we, in our day?
I have, I still do.
From the Jam, the Style Council and that. The Monkey House, it's going really well. Tell me about it.
Yeah, brilliant. Can't thank you enough for all the publicity you've done with that. Yeah, original interview, as we said, Animal Magnet, originally dance track, massive in the 80s.
Yeah.
With Kiss Me from Stephen Tintin Duffy, those two tracks.
Great song, buddy.
But yeah, so I just stripped it back to its original structure, really, and I would love to release it, as I've mentioned.
Yeah.
I've got some fantastic ideas that we could use, sitars in it, and, you know, like a really chill. You are. Exactly. So yeah, Monkey House, and when I've played it live, people of a certain age know the song, obviously.
I was there that night. They were singing it back to you.
It was brilliant.
How does that,
I'm getting goosebumps now thinking about it.
How does that feel, though, as an artist, when people are singing your lyrics back to you?
Well, that's all you want in life, isn't it? You know, unfortunately, I'm back in a bit time. Sorry, there's a friend of mine here, Tony Barbados.
His name,
Tony Barbados. Good friend of Paul Wellesley's. And Steve Craddock.
All right, Tom.
Yeah, Steve Craddock's a good friend.
I've just interviewed Steve. Yeah. You follow Steve on the Morning Show this week.
Oh, brilliant. Brilliant, I'll be listening.
Yeah.
But yeah, so yeah, when you've sat down and created something, and it's all your material, as you know, that's what all I do, apart from Monkey House.
Yeah.
When people sing it back, there's nothing better than, you know what I mean? It's what you want. It's like being a footballer, and you know what I mean? They're chanting your name.
Yeah. Different drive, isn't it?
It's brilliant. It's brilliant.
And what you got on the horizon? What's coming up now for Jack and Biscuit?
I'm supporting Sam Rogers in February. I'm going to be there. Sam's actually hit the headline. He's you know, I'm going to be supporting him. He's headlining his band, so I'm going to be the main support. I'm hoping to play there in December. I want to do a Christmas thing. There's all the Christmas parties. Everyone's going to be at Christmas parties.
Yeah.
I want to try and. But after February, I really don't know what's happening.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's difficult getting people to the gigs and.
Yeah.
I don't know. I've got an EP that I've just released.
Well, give us it.
I'll give you one of those.
We'll plug it, we'll put it on.
Yeah, free tracks on there. So, all my own material. Recorded professionally in the studio.
Yep.
I'm not just saying this, but I think it sounds super. I've had some really good feedback.
Brilliant.
To be fair. That people I've given.
Because that's what our shows are about. I designed these shows to do that. There's so much talent out there writing their own music, going up there and gigging, putting the records into the hands of radio stations. And unless you're attached to certain situations, you know, like the Gangnam style thing and a boy band, we don't play that on your show or the Almost Live. It's all about real, proper kids writing it, having it. And as I always say, if you think as Paul Weller as the tree, all the branches, all the trunks and all the leaves, anything like that, we'll stick it on our show.
It's fantastic.
All day long, mate. And Sam's his band, by the time this comes out, it's alright, it's what Paul Weller just called me. He was supposed to talking to Craddock, to be fair, but I'm claiming that.
In fact, I've got a story about Paul Weller. He told me to F off once, so did I tell you that?
Nah.
When they played at the Aston Villa Leisure Centre all those years ago, probably about 95, 96, I stopped by about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, the shutters was up.
Yeah.
I was in my suit, and they were doing a sound check, and the sound was terrible. I was standing in the doorway, just watching, and he turned around and you can, you know what I mean? It's like, what?
But you take it, wouldn't you? He's talked to you. Well, that has talked to you.
I just want to say hello, can I have my picture taken? I'll be happy then. I can die a happy man.
I was talking to Stephen indirectly, I talked to Paul. Right. I'm climbing in. I'm going.
Was it there?
I was going to stop you and say, yeah, Paul's behind you, but I thought, no.
There's Rob behind me. Paul Weller was behind me, doing to Craddock. I think you realise Craddock's a Villa fan.
Because Fowler's not, is he? Someone
no,
Fowler.
Blue nose, isn't it? So, like, let's get Merry Mouth on there as well.
Oh, definitely.
At the end of the day, we're all Biscuit Boys, mate.
We're all Biscuit Boys.
Jack,
that's brilliant.
I want to turn the home end at Soleil Moors into the Monkey House.
Really?
I swear, yeah. I've got these visions of things.
You've sat there so we can sleep building for half an hour.
Yeah, we've done Steve's on here as well. But like that, the Monkey... I've got a vision of a packed Soleil Moors in the Premier League, Champions League, you with your guitar in a few years' time, singing, welcome to the Monkey, and then I'm all going, la, la, la. Brilliant.
In fact, you could turn that around, couldn't you? You could use the Soleil Moors into that song.
Exactly.
jobs if you're clever enough.
Well, you're the boy that is clever.
Could come in.
Daz, can I say thanks for your time again, mate?
It's been amazing, mate. Thanks.
Always.
I've been listening Friday.
Always.
I want to come in on the show. I think it's brilliant.
You can come
you
in.
You guys have such a laugh.
Anytime we're recording it, come in, because that's what we do. With the Almost Live, it's just us having a laugh, talking about spiders, bumping dogs, anything. Sleeping blinders, the whole lot. Random. Top draw. Welcome in, Tom. Thanks, mate. Catch you later. Cheers, thank you. Hold on, you just sound just back in the car. You tell me now that your granddad was a runner for the bookies.
He was, Blinders, yeah. No, yeah. He was about 7 years of age. Grew up in Neatshalls and all the little betting shops and all the little pubs. Granddad used to run the tickets.
Is your granddad still
with you? No, unfortunately, he's died, but I wish he was still alive. Because I'm only listening to stories my uncles told me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So if my granddad would have been alive, he could have.
Blimey.
Yeah,
and the show, it's been great for Birmingham, hasn't it?
Amazing. Absolutely amazing. Out of film, out of, you know what I mean? It's just fantastic. Very clever.
Hopefully there'll be a second series and it'll go from strength to strength. And also as well, they're like biscuits. Thomas Shelby likes biscuits.
You're explosive that Steve give you.
Well, he's got to listen to that. We don't want to repeat it. You'll have to listen Friday for the exclusive.
Yeah, but if you listen to the exclusive Friday, you'll see it tonight. So.
So we might as well tell you. To be fair, might we? Yeah, we might. You know the Capes? Port Merriam.
Really?
Yeah. The prisoner.
Oh, right.
Yeah, that's what it's all about.
It's a promotion thing for the prisoner.
So where everybody thought, well, is it to the move or is it to the... Nah, slide that we're giving
them.
Yeah.
And they will be doing it.
They will be doing it where?
Tonight for the encore.
Oh yeah, absolutely. That's what they do. They're wearing it for the encore. They'll come out as like Batman, Jason. Jason and the Technicolor coat meets Batman, and that's what it is.
Steve gives you an exclusive. Oh, no. Tell him about
Oscar Newman. Anyway, see you later. Oscar Harrison,
mate. Oscar Collins' drummer.
If he wants a word on the Moore show, get Oscar on as well.
What's wrong?
I'll get him over.
Yeah, bring him over, bring Oscar over.
Starting to grow, and my feelings are starting to show.
Legend, Ocean Colour Scene drummer, Oscar.
Oh, geez, how are you?
Hi, mate.
I'm 30 Midland Song Warwater.
How's things?
Really good, really good. Really good.
Paul Weller here, I mean, Steve, part
absolutely,
of it.
Yeah.
You're all part of it. Ocean Colour Scene, 14th of December.
Absolutely.
You're back in Birmingham.
Absolutely.
In Merrymouth and with Simon and that. Onwards and onwards. You've come a long way, you guys, haven't you?
Absolutely. We've worked hard at what we're doing and we're really proud of what we've achieved as well. So, you know, it's all been really good.
Yeah.
The ride's been very, very good.
And like painting your more recent album.
Absolutely.
You know, your Mosley Shoals and like, what was it, how many years ago? 20 years ago, marching already.
Yeah, 25 years ago, yes, absolutely.
Time flies, Oscar, doesn't it?
Absolutely. I can't believe it's gone that quick, to be honest. But, you know, we've all enjoyed it. Even the bad times as well.
Yeah.
I mean, so it's been good. It's been really good.
And you know you are. You're one of Birmingham's greatest ever bands. Do you think of yourself as a band from Birmingham, though, or Solihull? Because Steve's from Solihull. You know, that everybody's not there. It's a Birmingham and Solihull situation, isn't it?
I think so, yeah, but the main thing is we're all from the Midlands. That's what matters, you know. I mean, the music was from here.
Yeah.
And we all, you know, played around Bob Lamb's studio as well.
Yeah.
And stuff like that. So, you know, we're a Birmingham-based band and we're proud of it.
And you used to, in the old days, you used to have the Mosley Shoals studio down in Shoecoke Street, didn't you?
That's right, yes. It was really good. It was like one of our first places. It was like our own little den kind of thing, I mean. Being responsible for your own place and that, and making wonderful music and just enjoying it. Yeah, it was really good.
And I used to be on the taxis in them days and taking people down there.
Yeah. I went one of them that run off and didn't pay with it.
No. Anyhow, mate. Oscar, thanks for your time.
Thank you, sir.
We play your records on the Moore Show and on the Almost Live Show.
Thank you very much.
Ocean Colour Scene, Paul Weller. I always say to people, think as Weller as the trunk. We all branch off in.
Lovely.
Well as God.
Peace and love, man. Wicked.
Cheers, mate.
Nice on, mate.
Hey, have you been watching Peaky Blinders? Because you got one of them caps on, Oscar.
No.
Cheers, mate. Thank you.
Talk about the ending.
Yeah, just shut up, will you? I'm recording. Thanks to all at the Wolf Civic last night with Paul Weller. Absolutely top draw, superb, loved it. And joining me now on the Moore Show, and finally, the other Biscuit Boy One, Chris.
Good evening, good
Mrs.
day.
Mrs. Brown.
Good welcome.
How are you?
Yeah, I'm okay, thanks.
Yeah. Chris.
You're going to tell me anyway, so I'm going to ask
you. One night, because I like to bounce off things. I'm bouncing off the walls.
Tell me everything.
I was like a kid in a sweet shop.
I've heard you.
I swear, honestly, it was like... And I had access to all areas there at Wolf Civic. Massive, I have to say, massive thank you to our mate Glue. Birmingham City Talk on Twitter.
Ada.
Yeah, and Bubble. You know, without
it's
them...
Like Bubble and Squeak, isn't it?
It is.
It could be the Squeak.
We could start calling him Squeak instead of Glue. Bubble and Squeak.
Go.
Well done.
There you go.
All fits together, don't it? But it wouldn't have been possible without their help. And boy, did they help me. I was so close to the stage. I was literally backstage interviewing with Steve Pilgrim, with Stevie Craddock. Steve Craddock didn't even know what inertia meant.
No. Well, we didn't really. We just guessed, didn't we?
We'll leave that.
And I believe you got to touch the man.
Shook hands with Paul Weller. Honestly. At the end, I swear.
Brilliant, eh?
Yeah.
Bet you're buzzing.
I am. And I'm still...
I bet you haven't washed the hand,
No, I haven't. Yeah. I'm going to be buzzing for some time. Because, you know, Paul Weller is my idol.
Mm-hmm.
I don't
mm-hmm.
know if he comes across that way.
Just a bit.
Yeah, but he kind of walked... I'd seen him earlier, but he's come walking, like, past, and I'm there in the corridor. Steve Pilgrim introduced. Paul, I'd just like you to meet.
Mm-hmm.
So he's like... Hello, God.
What did he say? Hello, God.
He just looked,
I've heard all your shows.
Yeah, he just looked. Oh, Jesus, that bleeding phone again.
Oh, God. There's
always a phone. That's my missus saying I picked up that certificate to get married.
It isn't. Yeah. It isn't. Might be
God.
I'll hold that.
Nah, we'll just let it go.
Okay.
We'll let it go.
Yeah.
That's showbiz, isn't it?
That's showbiz.
I mean, to be fair, it may even be Paul Weller.
To be honest, it probably isn't.
No, it's more chance of my missus.
Mm.
Or...
Where are you again?
PPI.
Could be,
It's always PPI, isn't it?
It's always a sound Welsh person as well. It's always Welsh.
Are they?
They're always Welsh.
Blimey.
Yeah.
Every PPI person is Welsh.
Yeah, yeah. It's a fact. Not well-known fact.
And the show's on a generic thing, sports radio, going from strength to strength.
Not half.
We've upped up now with B1%.
Yes, explain B1%, because I don't really know much.
Well, you will do when you listen to the show.
Okay.
Because Steve Pilgrim, who is part of 1%, he's one of the founders of B1%, he tells us all about it in the show. Hannah Weller, massive. In B1%.
Oh, I'm guessing she's related to Paul.
Married.
Right, okay.
Yeah. And we're up on the websites with everything. B1%, they had all the T-shirts at the concert, and the tour is going brilliant. So, happy days.
Brilliant.
Happy days. Brilliant. But we do come to the end of the show now. So, say goodbye, Mrs. Brown.
Goodbye, Mrs. Brown.
I know you was going to say that. And it is a good night from me. Thank you all for listening. Thank everybody for taking part. Karen Carney, all the people at Solihull Moors, the loving that I have with Marcus Bignett every week.
Emma. It does come across.
Well, Emery's Mrs. Dunnett as well this week. So, you know, so. But thank you all. Means so much. Paul Weller, God, Steve Pilgrim, Steve Craddock, even got Oscar from Ocean Colour Scene and Jack the Biscuit as well.
Even better?
Yeah, to everybody at the Wolf Civic. We're going to play out with the soundtrack, the greatest song ever written. You better stop dreaming of the quiet life. Take it away, God.